Geeta, I spent almost $600 at Costco today.
That was one of the funniest.
Everybody went to Costco today.
Arash,
you're the third person.
Well, he was with me.
He thought he could do everything in one cart, and I kept telling him, Ryan, we need another cart. It only took until the tail end of our trip where he's like, gonna need another cart. And I'm like, this kid, first day at Costco. Did you know the hot dogs are $1.50?
What were you buying? Like sour cream dip, onion dip, French onion dip for the wedding?
I was buying $600 worth of French onion dip for the wedding. It's going to be a lavish affair.
We get a lot of shots. Everybody come to the net. We just have to get more and more pucks to the net.
Banging the drum to get more pucks on net.
I know Ryan. He's a good guy.
We're getting pucks on net.
I'm about to listen to Pucks on Net.
What were you saying about putting pucks on net?
This is JT Miller, and you're listening to Pucks on Net.
Pucks on net and driving and making a hard night on them.
Live on tape from upwards of two locations. This is Pucks on Net, a Vancouver hockey podcast riddled with rampant speculation without sources. I haven't said it vocally out loud. I have not said it out loud in over a month, maybe two. Please call the PON Sauce Line, 604-283-9469.
Nice.
My name is Ryan Schapp. I'm going to be your host for the evening. Sitting on the left side of the couch, floating somewhere in the abyss in your screen, is Geeta, who has tucked away and hidden from in-law visiting on the island. Geeta, how are you doing?
I'm doing pretty well. I lost track of time. I was really enjoying this here glass of wine. I was watching the Macklin Celebrini interview going, oh, so that's what he looks like? He looks like a throwback to teenagers of yesteryear.
Does he? In what way? Glug.
Awkward. Unstylish haircut. Unless that's what stylish haircuts are today. I don't know. I will admit time has passed me by.
Yeah, we kind of stopped paying attention, and then all the teenage boys had that kind of broccoli haircut.
Like, we're still wearing skinny jeans and side parts, and like that's not what kids look like today.
No, I tried to not have a side part earlier this year and it did not work, and I accepted it.
And then we went back to the side part, so did I.
Speaking of side parts, on that side of the couch,
Jesus
Mr. Arash
from
Mars today, Prince of Pomegranate. Hey, what do you think of the neon sign over your shoulder?
Oh, yeah, I haven't seen it yet. It's on air.
I get it. It's hard to see on Zoom, but it says on air. I bought it on Amazon.
Oh, there we go. Now you're bigger and I'm smaller. I can't see it. It's blurry.
Aww.
So it looks like there's a halo around Arash, as there should be.
So angelic.
I've got an idea. It's called waiting to spend your cap space.
Well, hang on.
Wait for 45 minutes. I got a bender to go on, but we'll see.
I want to tell you this. I have a little teaser to give both of you.
Oh.
Because not the next podcast, but the podcast after next will be the exclusive. Not exclusive because it will be available everywhere. The big wedding day podcast.
Oh, my God.
So there's two podcasts next week.
There'll be one on Monday and one on Saturday.
Wait, what?
Okay.
Why do we need to do that?
Because I'm a groom.
That's why he asked you to be in his wedding party. Long con. He knew where you were going to be the morning of his wedding. So he could hold you hostage.
Get a mic in front of that boy's face.
Yeah. I'm a fucking rented mule.
I like Arash. Don't know if I like Arash and Geeta that much. But I need them to work for me on the wedding. We don't get wedding day off.
No, it's a long.
The entire time you're like, Rash, you're not going to do anything all day. You're going to relax. You're going to enjoy yourself. You're not going to think about the pizza mines. It's going to be great.
Feeding Arash grapes?
You're feeding me grapes. You're going to get a pedicure. It's going to be great. And then Ryan now comes along and just be like, hey, pal. I'm going to need a good 2 hours for me.
Arash is going to have cucumbers on his eyes as he rests and recovers, and all of a sudden the headset's strapped onto his dome.
Hey, guys, what do you think if we trade Hronik and Hoglander for Natchez, but they're negotiating rights to Jake Guentzel, huh?
I will say...
Oh, my God, I hope he signs that morning so that the wedding has to be delayed.
Big things happen at co-host weddings.
How are you feeling about the wedding? We're what, 1 week out?
No.
2 weeks out?
about that.
3 weeks out, 4 days out.
As long as everybody has properly fitting trousers, I'm not worried.
Everything. Geeta, have you been on this where he's telling us about the pants? He's asking us the fact that we're in our 30s, that you don't worry, we're going to get great pants.
Do you have great pants, Arash?
Absolutely not yet, but I'm going to get them. What? It's just gray pants. I can literally get gray pants anywhere.
Arash, I haven't
you
seen...
You can't.
Oh, well.
You better get...
They were out of season.
That'd be so funny if
don't,
I went.
Hey, don't say that too loud.
They did not have them in store at Aritzia. I had to order them in.
Again, Aritzia. Yes, Arash... When you look at me...
Arashia.
Screaming Aritzia. Just scream, shout, Aritzia. That's how my vibe is.
What I was going to say was I have gone out of my way to purchase some gifts for my wedding party.
You keep saying this, and now the more you mention that you
are you going
gifts,
to spoil wedding day for us by telling us what these
just tell
gifts
us what
are,
it is
are they inappropriate and erotic?
Yeah, they are erotic playing cards.
It's killing me, and I just want to know what it is. What is it?
I won't tell you.
Come on.
Yeah, I'm not
are
going
they
to
drink tickets. Oh, I purchased they... you all drink tickets.
Like, I will. Okay, that's a. I won't tell people. I'll give you each one of those, a little punch card.
Oh my god!
They feature your faces on it too.
They do. $10 for the drinks. Holy
yeah,
shit!
Yeah, that's a $10 value.
Quick, what else can we bully out of Ryan right now?
Let's see. Yeah, Ryan, we're not going to proceed with the show until Geeta and I's demands are met.
listen, I'm backed into a corner here.
Reed is posting goodbye messages on Instagram stories already.
He's just like, good
last day in Vancouver. Where are they going? I guess they're not signing on Pucks on Net.
Geeta and I, what can I say? Ryan forgot to send the fax. We're RFAs. But then Ryan forgot to send the qualifying offer fax. And just like Andrew Ladd and Dustin Byfuglien and Cam Barker of the time,
Atlanta.
Geeta, I think we can announce.
Arash and I are going to Dallas, sucker.
Geeta, I think we can announce. We are going to Barstool. Just kidding. You couldn't pay us enough to be a part of that.
They would eat you alive.
They would eat me alive because they're like, you're not white. 100%. What is this, bro? You know who's crazy? Chicks. Oh, I can't say that anymore. I'm like, what the fuck? This is hockey? This is really? Anyway.
Anyway, you all get.
I would go to, like, what does Shane O'Brien do now? What's that one?
He has a podcast.
Off the mitts off or something like that.
Mitts off, off the mitt.
With Scotty Upshaw.
No, Scotty Upshaw.
I don't know.
Try that.
Isn't it so
I'd
funny?
Come back.
Isn't it so funny?
I'd take a year there.
Isn't it so funny
I'm
when
so
you think
sorry,
of like those podcasts? Yeah, like those like white dude podcasts, like hockey podcasts. What are they all called? Like Off the Mitts.
Pucks on Net.
Pucks on Net. Slinging Biscuits.
I don't know if you know the history of Pucks on Net.
The white. Canucks didn't.
It's white.
In that game 7, they had no idea what the hell that was called. I had a great discussion with my brother who recently came back from a trip, and he's like, yeah, it's true. I did. It really disappointed me. I'm like, pal, I've been living it for the last month, man. Like, what are you?
I'm sitting in it here.
I'm sitting in it. I'm stewing in it. I already talked about it. Where it's over.
We're in the midst of game one. Or game two of the Stanley Cup Final is just mm-hmm. underway. Geeta and I have picked the Oilers in six.
Boo.
Mm-hmm. I don't think we like the pick.
We don't like it. It was hard to make, but we made it the night before game six. We made it. It was Saturday night last week in Vegas. 2 weeks ago? Last weekend?
Before you tell me before the West Final was done, you've already picking the Oilers to win the cup?
Yeah. Do you not remember us sitting sadly at that bar? And I'm like, oh, I can see the Oilers. I can, the parade is going through my head right now. and then the very next night, the Oilers won. And we're like, this will come. Yeah.
Yeah. And how it always seems to happen with them, they have a stinker or they have a game that that's completely out of reach in game one. And then they evolve.
They'll have a big game tonight.
Oh, I know.
I don't know. They're getting outshot 1-0.
then Florida will win the first game. And then in the next city, and then the Oilers will just wrap it up or something.
Yeah, they'll win it in six and make it seem so easy. I got to say, I'm really impressed with Connor McDavid's beard.
So were that...
It's big.
Okay. I was going to say, I was really impressed with Connor McDavid's answer about why he liked living in Edmonton.
That was so great. Like, he had time, too.
You know when you're like...
People are so friendly.
He says that when he tried to go buy beer, and he was accosted by a group of people just like grabbing him.
When he says like the people are so passionate, I just think like this mental image of him at the beer store parking lot with the guys like swarming. Please, please give me a hug. Like that's just going through his brain.
And then like basically climbing into his trunk.
Yeah.
With
Oilers fans, it's like when they see that, they're like, oh, it's passion. It's heart.
But
they
when
just
we
care.
Burn down a
but
city.
When we do it, it's like, oh, are the Canucks fans the worst fan base? And I know we're bad, but they're truly awful. They're a gosh darn
awful. And then
they
do a documentary about it.
And we do a documentary about it. And did you guys watch it?
Not yet.
I haven't watched it yet. And I saw some scuttlebutts on Twitter saying, like, for those unaware, ESPN 30 for 30 did one on the 2011 Stanley Cup Riot. Good thing the counter is at zero, so we can mention it. And it was done by the same filmmaker who did the Big Country.
Yeah.
And I think she did another Grizzlies.
Yeah, the Grizzle Truth.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So I trust the person telling the story, but I don't know if I'm that gung-ho to relive it, or...
I feel like the criticism or the critique on it was that, like, it was a lot of people going, they didn't know they would get in trouble.
Yeah, that was, like, so many of the people that they interviewed were like,
my parents rioted, why couldn't I? Which just, it's the funniest.
Yeah,
logic.
You don't really have the sympathetic protagonist in this, and you're just like, I'm supposed to feel sympathy for you, but you... rioted and were caught on camera.
Well, that's the thing. Like, how do you sympathize with a sports rioter?
Man, how do you sympathize with a sports rioter? Is really,
guys, I got arrested for bashing the windows at the Bay and stealing designer purses and selling them on Craigslist. I'm the victim here.
I was under the impression that it was like the Purge, that for 2 hours after the 2011 Stanley Cup Final, all crime was legal. I was under the assumption. Now, can I ask them, should I be put away in jail for having passion? Should I be thrown away in jail for having a misunderstanding of what was legal and illegal?
Does a crime
at the time?
Define crime of passion. That's all I'm saying.
I don't know, Ryan. I don't know, guys.
I might watch it, but I got other dopamine kicks.
Pressing
of
matters.
I got dopamine kicks of nostalgia waiting for me elsewhere, and I don't know if that one's that. Geeta, your time is limited this week, so did you watch Game 1 of the Stanley Cup Final?
I want to say I did, but I can't remember it. Time means nothing. No. Rowan's having a tough go right now. Kate Baxter and I were in an Airbnb. Kate Baxter, a good friend of the show. We tried to watch it. We tried to stream it. It wasn't working, so we watched it on our phone for a little while. As Rowan screamed at us, he's like, turn this off. Canucks season is over.
Attention to Rowan, please. No, not to this other child known as McDavid.
So I made every attempt to watch it.
I also made every attempt to watch it.
Neither of you guys watched the first game of Stanley Cup.
I watched.
We tried to sympathize with us.
AKA the Rafi Torres game.
We need sympathy.
The Rafi Torres game.
Yes, the Rafi Torres game, accurately put. I watched 40 minutes at Amanda's parents, because we were doing wedding setup, and then I came home. I'm like, time to watch the third period, and I was so exhausted from wedding stuff, I fell asleep.
Nice.
So nothing happened in that third period, but I don't think I missed anything.
Here we go, classic Pucks on Net trope. Got to rely on Arash to carry the analytical side of things. Okay.
Where's the heat map?
Where's the heat map? Because it was my eyes towards the TV. Mm-hmm. Let me tell you. For you guys that didn't watch game one, it was the Oilers won that game. It's just they got Bobrovsky'd. The Oilers won. I mean, they had shots and control, and they won. They should. They're technically up 1-0.
Yeah.
But it's the goalie. So they won, though.
I hope that's the analysis after Florida's creating the Stanley Cup, and then we're being told that. But the Oilers swept this series.
It's just so funny. It's just so funny how after game one, in order like not to be demoralized or anything, like what I saw from the Panthers was a team that capitalized on their chances, and Sergei Bobrovsky was making like just amazing saves. Yeah. Like he had a like a windmill stack in the pad save that got me out of my seat and everything. But yeah, I mean, listen, the Oilers for a large part of that game, I mean, they were, you know, controlling play and getting shots on net and everything. But at the same time, like, we saw how physical Florida is on the forecheck. We saw mm-hmm. how deep that team is. And we saw, you know what? You pay $10 million for a good goalie. You pay that money and just, you either, like, you just put it in the back of your mind and you go from there. And
I was told Stu Skinner is a good goalie. I've been told this for like 2 or 3 months now.
He had a couple of weeks where he was a bad goalie, but I mean, Stu Skinner hasn't really been a problem for a series and a half.
Okay, we'll see. Listen, the numbers don't lie, man. I just feel like there's gonna be one of those games where it's gonna be like OEL from the red line, and then just absolute fucking clapper and bit their bar down and they're like, oh, Pickard, we need Pickard to come save us.
One of those games where Stu Skinner gets pulled and has to go back in.
Probably they're going to get Grant Fuhr or whoever, Bill Ranford or whatever. Who else is available in the
Curtis
alumni
Joseph.
Lounge?
Yeah, he's hanging out.
He's hanging out.
Yeah, but that would lead TSN to be like, well, what if the Leafs had Curtis Joseph? They could be there today.
If
what?
Curtis Joseph was in the stands for Leafs games like he is for Oilers games, honestly, I say John Tavares, Conn Smythe Trophy winner.
One time.
We joked that we didn't watch it, but game one of the Stanley Cup Final drew 7.1 million viewers across North America, which is a 43% increase over last year. Goes to show how many Canadians are watching, and goes to show how much more of a draw, I guess, the Oilers are than the Vegas Golden Knights. So I thought that's pretty
good. When there's like a week without sports, we're like, we want some sports.
Yeah. There was no sports last week.
When does the NFL start?
Labor Day?
Yeah, like September.
I've definitely been feeling it.
We do our first draft the Tuesday after Labor Day, right? So
yeah,
the weekend after.
Let's
go Lions.
Which
one? We got the BC Lions.
Oh, I'm like Detroit.
Vernon Adams, we got him. 50 Cent. Guys, did you hear about this? 50 Cent's coming.
50 Cent.
50 Cent.
Sold it out.
Sold out.
Geeta, we'll put a pin in you for this week before you get tasked with two podcasts next week. I have one ask for you, a question.
Okay.
I'm gonna subtly update the wall here because I had the shelf and then we kept knocking it down with the new couch.
Okay.
I want you to maybe afterwards and you can let me know, but I want to put a picture or two up behind us, preferably a funny hockey picture.
Okay.
So there's the one of Phil Kessel leaning in the dressing room with his ripped up undies playing for Vegas.
Right.
There's Louis Erickson's face after he let in the empty net goal own goal against Calgary. If something swirls in that very big, much more efficient brain of yours, you let us know.
Well, there's Joe Thornton on his riding lawnmower. That one's
good. That's a good bit.
That's pretty damn good. God, see? I love
That's
it.
That's why she's part of the show. That's why she's the matriarch of Pucks on Net.
I like all these descriptors. Geeta, go back to the family responsibilities. And I also got you a present from the team store sale. I can't wait to give you.
I know what
person.
It is.
Exciting.
Yeah.
I hope you like a game used Tucker Pullman stick.
I'm so excited for wedding day and all the presents I'm gonna get.
It's actually nuts. Like, for a day that's about you and Amanda, like, we're getting a lot of stuff.
He's getting showered with gifts here.
Oh, lordy.
All right. I'll talk to you next week, Geeta.
Okay. Love you both.
Love you too. So, before we get back to hockey, Arash.
Boo!
You notice we have two beers on the table.
Yeah, what is the story behind that?
Okay, last couple years, Phillips has done a Solaris White Peach Ale.
Okay.
Like, out of bounds, my favorite drink.
Okay.
Favorite summertime beer. It took the Whistler Grapefruit Ale,
yeah,
kicked it to the curb like yesterday's garbage.
That Grapefruit Ale gets you fucked up.
One of my worst hangovers ever was on Grapefruit Ale.
Oh, my God.
Where I said, hey, these taste so good, let's drink another six-pack. So I was at the liquor store on Dollarton, Stongs.
Hey, my hood.
Yeah, your hood.
It's and where I sowed my oats.
Yeah.
Dang. Good old dang Dollarton.
So I've seen this new Solaris. Like, the peach one had that name, yeah, and I looked it up online, and it says peach, but it's also a few more other flavors. And I'm like, I'll get this one, and if it's not that, I will also get this Stanley Park Sunsetter Peach Wheat Ale.
Yeah.
And so far, neither one of them compare.
Yeah, beer's beer, man. You just got to drink it to get to the next beer. And like, then after that second beer, it's game over.
And then you get to the brown liquor.
Oh, Donnie, I'm telling you, you get to it and then the notifications are off. Milstein's calling. I'm not answering. It's going straight to voicemail.
You know what's so great? When you were younger and drinking.
Yeah.
And you'd like wake up hungover and you're like, oh man, what did I got to go through my text messages or look
to
at what
see,
I
see like who I message and what did I do.
And now, like, in our 30s, relationshipy or not.
Yeah.
I feel like maybe after 30, the phone just like you're smart enough like this is not what I need. I'm just gonna keep this away and just
be
in the pocket.
Dude, when I'm absolutely slammered, it's less about like who I'm messaging now and more like did I just like order something off of like Temu or something? did I just go get like a knockoff Martin St. Louis jersey because I was like I deserve it.
I love buying drunk stuff. I once bought a...
What's your most drunk purchase? I'll tell you. Mine's low, but it's hilarious.
Well, I've had a couple things. Like, I had to take some vacation, and I was in Kamloops for work and had a handful of Jack and Cokes in me, and I booked a Hawaiian vacation.
What?
But I needed to, like... I would have done it regardless.
Right.
But it's like, booking a flight under the influence is like the best feeling in the world because it's done.
Yeah.
And now it's like, okay, like with any vacation, you you can come up with a million ways to justify not doing it, you know, because it'll cost this or cost that. But man, if you just like book it and figure out, we'll have to figure it out now. Like I love that feeling.
Nice.
But I would say my drunkest purchase, something intense just happened on the ice here.
What happened?
It's 27, I think, for Florida's down.
27. Ooh.
Yeah.
Itu Lustarainen?
Yeah, like he got leveled.
Oh, wait. Did he get leveled or did he get clipped?
I don't know.
By a fucking rat. Vander Kane's playing.
So anyway,
typical Vander Kane.
Before we go to the replay, my drunk purchase like that, which is way too much money, was a vinyl copy of If You Know, You Know. Daytona by Pusha T.
Okay, yeah. Like amazing.
Amazing
album.
The best of the Kanye-produced albums.
Yes.
And, like, it probably was $75 with shipping and conversion.
And now you're not single anymore, so you can't do the whole, hey, I listen to Pusha T. What's up? Okay, what's here? There's that.
Yeah.
Wait, is CeCe in?
Here's the hit.
No, that's not the hit.
What?
That's
Twitter.
Oh, is that a little clippy? Is that a little clippy stuff?
I don't know what happened there.
Vander Kane, Jesus Christ, man. Oh, damn, that's a loss.
I can't tell if he was trying to evade him or not.
I don't know.
Oh.
But that's Itu Lustarainen. That's a big that's a big depth loss for the Florida Panthers. Having a good time. My most drunk purchase, and I'm going to show it to you right now, is you're going to laugh. You ready? Ladies and gentlemen, my most drunk purchase was on the Apple Store, and it is the song Now We Are Free by Lisa Gerrard from the major motion picture Gladiator. If you know what the song is, you know. It's the song that plays at the very end.
$2?
I don't know how much it was, but let me tell you, I was blasted out of my mind. And this was before Spotify, so I literally was like, I just need to... You know, it's that song, it's like...
Kinda.
You gotta watch Gladiator, pal. They're coming out with Gladiator 2.
Oh, they need... Russell Crowe needs work?
Well, it's... No, Ryan, he's dead. Did you, have you watched Gladiator before?
No.
Oh, Jesus Christ. Okay, you know what? Gladiator was released 24 years ago, so you don't have an excuse. He dies at the end of the movie. It's very... It's very plain. And if people
and then
come at me...
I remember Russell Crowe's famous line in what? Gladiator. What? This is Spartan.
Nope.
Nope.
That's cute. His most famous line is probably what he tells, what's his name, Joaquin Phoenix.
You got to fight for your right to party.
No.
You got to walk hard.
No.
You got to walk the line. You got to marry June Carter Cash.
Oddly enough, closer, but not.
you got to be a disruptor on your late night with David Letterman appearances.
Or is it father to a murdered wife, general to a murdered someone, king or whatever. And I will have my vengeance in this life or the next. It's great. It's wonderful work. Wonderful work. Ryan, can I give a little shout out to someone?
No.
Someone, please let me do it. It's great.
No. Is it a shout out to your buddy in the UK who's somehow bought 3 Pucks on that shirts?
Batu? No. Batu's doing great, by the way.
Yeah, he bought 3.
He bought one he and he lost it or it got fucked up. And then he bought another 2 XLs.
And I said, hey, well, I'll cut you a deal. Worst deal I've ever cut.
Yeah, because you got murdered on shipping, but it's what we do for the people we love.
Yeah.
Can I give a shout out to someone?
It better be good.
It's going to be good. I'm going to give a shout out to someone near and dear and close to my heart. One Thomas Drance, who made one of the most amazing references I have ever heard in the medium of podcasting and radio. Absolutely insane. On the PDO cast with Dimitri Filipovic, they were talking about the Stanley Cup being... shown in the arena.
Love it publicly.
Right?
I mean, I like it.
In the background.
Yeah.
Right? So you can see it. The players can see it. All that stuff, right? So I wrote
Kneeing major,
5 minutes. I wrote this note at 12:48 in the morning while I was going to bed because I listened to the PDO cast go to sleep. There is no better hockey podcast to put on to go to sleep to and become educated than the PDO cast. That's as much as I'm going to say. Drancer made one reference that was basically saying that the Stanley Cup being in the arena is akin to... Did you ever play Mortal Kombat at all?
To an extent.
Okay. It is basically akin to the Mortal Kombat level designs like in Super Nintendo where the people would be fighting and then in the background would be like thing like just an active thing happening in the background. Mm-hmm. So like you're fighting but there's obviously something in the background. And so the thing that popped into my head, if you've played Mortal Kombat, it's the Shang Tsung level where Shang Tsung is in the back sitting there watching the two people fight. I have been trying to explain what my feelings towards this whole Stanley Cup in the building thing is. Drance made one of the most absurd, completely niche metaphors that resonated with me so hard that I put a note in my notes app, and I was like, I got to give him love. So, right, it's amazing. Ryan, what do you think about the Stanley Cup being in the arena? Don't give me an
I mean, it's there.
No, but it's great. It's like the thing. It's there. It's there anymore. Yeah, but like the whole pageantry of bringing it out and wiping it down is like,
I don't know.
Well, you know, it'd be great if they put it in a place where the players could go immediately go get it. Like the doors open. It's not even Gary bringing it out. It's like the doors open and they don't even have to wait and do handshakes. They can literally go grab the damn thing. And in the lineup, they're like shaking hands while the guy's having the cup. He's like, ah, good job.
Annie,
you should have four-checked harder.
I didn't like it as much as other people loved it. I really liked the showing of, like, here's what it's about.
Yeah.
And you think that every player would know what it is and know what they're playing for and fighting for because they've done it their whole lives.
Right.
But the reaction of them when they saw it, like, they are just like...
Like Ovi being like, holy crap, I'm about to lift up the cup.
It's like, you immediately strip away any contract value, any notoriety. They're all kids trying to win it.
Yeah.
And it kind of, anything to bring that human element back to the game, I'm all for. So I love that. But then I love that they take it away.
Yep.
And it's not there until, you know, it's an elimination game. And then you see that blonde bastard with the worst hair you've ever seen.
Mm-hmm.
Bill Pritchard or whatever, slug that mother
Bill,
in.
Bill Pritchard.
What's his name? Glenn Pritchard? Bruce something?
Bruce Pritchard? Yeah, Bruce Pritchard. No, it's Bruce Pritchard.
It is.
And listen, you motherfuckers, man. You want the cup, man? Bruce Pritchard, man.
I tell you what. Let's take a break here. We'll go back. We'll go into Sauce It or Toss It.
Uh-oh. It's the first Sauce It or Toss It Arash has written in at least a month because he forgot to do them all.
I just kind of helped out a pal.
Thank you, pal.
And then after the break, we'll do Sauce It or Toss It. We'll be talking about some more about the Stanley Cup Final. The salary cap has finally gone up. And a strange purchase by the Washington Capitals.
And it's not drugs. You'll be shocked to find out what it is after the break.
All right, gang, what's going on? It's the middle of the show. It's the middle of the podcast. I'm sitting here in the car wash. It's the middle of June. You know, our whips that we borrow from our much more successful partners, they got to be pristine. They got to be fresh to death, and that's what we're doing. If you want to be fresh to death, there's no better way to do it than buying a Pucks on Net t-shirt. I shipped a few of them this weekend. They are moving fast, and supplies rather limited. Any size, if you want a small, a large, maybe an XL, if not a 2XL, they're $35 Canadian. And if you live within Metro Vancouver, even though I'm busy as hell preparing for a wedding, if you live in Metro Vancouver, you are welcome to free delivery or free pickup, and I will drive it to you in this here electric Kona. If you don't live in Metro Vancouver, that's just $15 Canadian to ship it to you within Canada. Let's say you live in the United States, that's $17 Canadian to ship it to you in the United States. And if you live anywhere around the world, we're charging you a song and a bargain at $22 Canadian to ship it anywhere around the world. Those are all Canadian prices, so if you're in the States, you are laughing all your way to the bank. And most importantly, we're giving you all deals on shipping. So we just want to make everybody look cool. And what's going on with this beard? We just want to sell these shirts. There's not a lot left. And, you know, when they're gone, they're gone. If you want one, you can send me a DM, you can send us a comment, you can message any one of us, or just send us an email, pucksonetca@gmail.com, and we'll go from there. Accept PayPal, e-transfers, dirty cash exchanges if you're local. That's a great way to help out to support the show. If you want to help support this show, the best way to do it is going to patreon.com/pucksonnet. patreon.com/pucksonnet. This is a $20 car wash, and I assure you that the Patreon money is not going towards this $20 car wash. That's a great way to support the show. That's a great way to get bonus content. You can join our Discord. You can join the Fantasy Hockey League. And it's you can also get bonus merch, exclusive merch that's only available to Patreon backers. And that's at the $15 and $25 tier. Great way to support the show. Every dollar that you give us gets invested right back into the podcast. We just strive to make our show look and sound and be produced as well as possible, and that's where every one of your hard-earned dollars gets spent. If you don't want to support the show monetarily, I completely understand. Best way to do that, interact with us on social media, like our content, comment on our content. Oh, here comes the blue stuff. And follow us on Instagram, follow us on TikTok, follow us on PucksNetCA or PucksNetCA. And finally, rate and review the podcast on Apple Podcasts. Rate and review the podcast on Spotify. Rate and review the podcast if you get podcasts from somewhere and you haven't done it yet. If you rated and reviewed the podcast like 10 years ago, go do it again, resubmit it. It all helps. It all helps defeat the awful algorithm, and it helps spread the word. So that's all we're asking you to do. Hard-earned money, many steps of responsibility, buying shirts, telling friends.
And my wedding's coming up, so the ideal wedding gift is buying a shirt or supporting us on Patreon. Will Amanda see any of that money? Probably not. Maybe that's not the most ideal gift. All right, back to the show.
Ryan, sauce it or toss it? Philip Peronic getting above a $7 million arbitration value.
How many years?
He can only, it's either one or two. It's arbitration. You can't do a long-term thing.
Toss, and throughout this sauce it or toss it,
yeah.
There's going to be a trend, and it all kind of goes with what players can be, you know, how the cap has gone up. I don't see a guy that having the year he had, like, yes, he is a good player and he compliments Quinn Hughes, but I'm not ready to believe that the drop off would be that drastic mm-hmm. with him leaving. And like, if his one job is to
drop off for who?
Hronek.
Gotcha.
Sorry, Quinn Hughes' drop off with Hronek leaving.
Well, it's
like it seems like Hronek is one job and one responsibility, and that's to make Quinn Hughes win another Norris Trophy.
Yeah, I think we're getting a little mixed up here in that. Quinn Hughes doesn't need Philip Peronic.
He just doesn't need Noah Juulsen.
Yeah, he just doesn't need Noah Juulsen. Like, you could put Dylan DeMello. Like, doesn't need to be a grand spanking top flight dude. And if you want someone who can be like the entire thing should be, how do you get a value version of Philip Peronic?
Exactly.
How do you get Timothy Liljegren out of Toronto? Yeah. That's kind of like the idea. How do you get a dude who can skate and pass and do all that stuff? And guess what? If you can't find that, then you go the tried and tested way, getting a big dump truck defensive defenseman right by Quinn Hughes. How do you do it?
How?
I don't know.
You tell me.
We'll find out July 1st. Ryan, a cap-friendly clone being called Friends with Cap Space. Trademark.
It was really funny when Arash sent me this. It did crack me up.
Friends with Cap Space.
I got an audible lol and a when he sent it. I'm saucing it. There will soon be an equivalent of it available. I mean,
it's Puckpedia. If people haven't been on Puckpedia yet, that's probably going to be the best bit of information I can give you is that once Cap Friendly goes dark, it's Puckpedia. And Puckpedia is actually really cool.
There was a site before Cap Friendly, and then that got bought.
It's Cap Geek.
Yeah.
No, well, Cap Geek is Cap Friendly. Just the person who made Cap Geek passed away.
That's what it was.
Right, and then they rebranded, I think, to...
Do you have any idea why the Capitals would buy it?
Any idea? I mean, the only kind of ideas that I could think about is that it takes away another platform for... Like, you can bring it in-house and all that information now goes to strictly just being used by the Capitals.
They could also pay people, have make it a subscription service.
Yeah, would we probably? I mean, we could write it off.
I go there so much.
I mean, it's absurd. Yeah. Especially if the Caps put in some money in it and they're like, hey, you know what? We're gonna do some fun stuff with it.
Here's my tinfoil hat thought.
Yeah.
The Washington Capitals motto next year is going to be that they are cap friendly.
Damn it. That's good.
And like, it'll be like, you know.
I hate when Ryan says something good.
What's the.
Because I'm like, why didn't I
like
think
anime, that? Anime drawings of Ovi and TJ Oshie and Backstrom, and they're all like, we're cap friendly.
We're cap friendly.
Like, you know, we're a safe place. Come enjoy the game.
Yeah, we're cap friendly. We're below the salary cap, so you know we're not going to get penalized. We're going to dress 20. We're going to dress 20 people every night.
And we.
And unlike my inner Miami or whatever, we will make sure our star players are there. Ryan. Canucks trading for Jake Gensel's rights before July 1st.
Big toss.
Oh, really?
They don't have a first.
No. What they? Okay,
they don't have
not,
a second.
You're not going to trade a They're first or a second. We're talking about a third or a fourth.
I don't need this team not having a draft pick in the first three rounds.
Oh, God.
I
used to get so excited for the NHL. I guess this is the toss-up between being Jim Benning's Canucks. I mean, even Jim Benning's Canucks didn't have picks, man. Why can't
I just don't like the idea of I'm looking at the way my lizard brain responds to having more money than I thought I would have.
Uh-huh.
And then being like, well, now we can afford the Jake Gensel. Now we can afford the Elias
Lindholm.
They
got like
Lindholm.
$25 million in cap space, pal.
Yeah,
with
but they also
Tucker Pullman LTIR.
He's still there. Them. They're not going to lose that.
I know, but I'm saying like it's $23 million and then $2.5 million once they put him on LTIR.
Yeah, and then you give $7 million to Hronek. You give $8.5 million to Jake Gensel. You give $4 million to, you know, what's his face?
They need
Dakota Joshua.
They need to fill out 6 positions on their roster.
Yeah, and I don't want
Tyler Myers comes back at 2.5-3.
No, there's too many teams that are going to get drunk with this money.
They're going to get drunk with the cap space.
I think Gensel could make $9.5 million.
Oh, he could, yeah. Because realistically, in 2 years, what percentage of the cap is going to be? I mean, that's the way you got to look at it, as opposed to the cap hit. It's the percentage of the cap that the cap hit takes up.
Yeah, and I don't. It's not the time.
I can't wait till we come out and be like, you know what? I want to give him 4% of the cap. And like, that's the way we talk about it. Because that really has to be kind of the way that we look about it, certain things. Especially when it fluctuates.
I know the Canucks need to build on a very positive season. But I don't. And they need wingers. But I don't know if moving more assets to negotiate.
Hey, I got a question for you. How about instead of signing Jake Gensel, they just wait. They just wait for some teams to completely screw themselves over with the cap. And they're like, hey, we got cap space. You need to trade Shea Theodore or something? Sure.
I'd love it.
I got money.
But just now is not the time for a big spend on a guy that you don't know. Like, oh, he'll fit in with Pettersson because of this reason. He'll fit in with JT Miller because of that reason. I'm like, man, I'm not ready for the Canucks to take all the good graces of the year they just had and just spend like mad.
Wait until the Canucks take all the good graces about the year they just had and spend mad on July 1st right here on Pucks on Net. Patreon.com/PucksOnNet.
604-283-9469.
Cap space. Ryan, shortening the NHL draft in the next CBA. Ooh.
I thought about it for a while because we listened to, you know, it's a late news week on 32 Thoughts when they're just having 10 or 15 minute arguments off the top about,
oh my God,
any this or that. But I like having, like, they've already, it went from 9 rounds or whatever to 7 rounds.
To 7, yeah.
And I like that these.
How about 13 rounds?
I think 7 is
13 rounds, the John Cena movie.
That's 12 rounds reloaded.
12 rounds, why not?
But I like that being 7 rounds. I like that you have some currency to still work with.
Yep.
And I like that with that 7th round, the Dallas Stars can just pick whatever Kamloops Blazer they feel like taking.
Yeah, it'll be our first one.
And or, you know, who, you know, a Nepo baby gets to go in the 7th round.
Nice.
But you have that you have a little bit of currency to work with in terms of making deals and shit like that. So I say keep it. I am a very big proponent and enthusiast of making bumping up a draft year to 19.
Oh, yeah.
I would love that so much. It would benefit junior hockey so much.
I also, like, I think it would benefit the kids. Like, how do you know what a kid is at 18?
Exactly.
It's, like, how do you know?
It's the biggest everybody wins situation, and I'm all for it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Love it. Ryan, I love this one. If Bobrovsky wins a cup, is he a lock for the Hockey Hall of Fame? We're talking about how many Vezinas? 2 Vezinas, over 400 wins.
Yes, sauce it.
I mean, Roberto made the Hockey Hall of Fame. How many wins?
He's got 1.5 gold medals.
And 1.5 gold medals.
Yeah, I'd say Bob gets in. There's a longevity aspect. He's got Vezinas. He's got the most important medal of all, a World Juniors
a medal of
medal.
Honor. He
and if he wins a cup, I kind of feel if the Panthers win the cup, he's going to be a pretty big pick for Conn Smythe.
Yeah, 100%.
I'll sauce that.
Okay, perfect. Ryan? And the big one for me and Ryan today, because we both went to Costco. Ryan, the new Kirkland Comfort Runners. Let me tell you what happened. We were shopping. I had my limit of what I wanted to spend. I was like, you know what? I'm good.
How excited have you been about these shoes?
Because how? No, the question is, When you told me, what was my reaction?
You bewildered. You didn't believe me. And I said, the Kirkland Walkers are over there. And you're like, no. They're, like, there was a look of like, no. Well, they're like, come on. Let's quit fucking around here. And I pointed them out. And you kind of blindly walked towards some slides. And I'm like, oh, he's not seeing them. And then, like, the you know, over the hill and far away was the pile of Kirkland shoes. And Arash did not come back for at least 5 minutes.
I didn't.
I stood by the giant things of lemon juice waiting
for
him.
Well, I came back not only with the pair of shoes, but I believe was two huge containers of margarine and Dr. Prager's California burgers. And what did I tell you when I came back? I was like, Ryan, I got Costco'd.
Yeah.
I got Costco'd. Look at me go. I got Costco'd, pal. What can I do? But yeah, no, for people who don't know, Costco has these new runners. I don't want anyone to know what I'm wearing or what brand it is. I just love no logos, no nothing. Look at how beautiful these shoes are. Look at them. They're gorgeous. And how comfortable were they?
I haven't put them on yet.
You got to put them on, Ryan. Well, you got to put them on. They're so nice. They're absolutely so gorgeous and nice.
The other line, I went in flops and Arash is like, you got to try these on. And I'm like,
I don't have socks.
I'm like, just do it. Just do it. So I try on a pair with my bare feet, and then I joke to Arash. I'm like, well, I'll just grab another pair. I don't want to buy a pair that some D-gens tried on with no socks on. So,
well, look at you go.
I'll let you know, but I'm saucing at a $40 sensible shoe.
I mean, come
might go a long way.
It might. And guess what? When the shoe screws up or whatever, you just take it back to Costco. You just take it back.
That's very funny.
You just be okay. Sorry. Dog ate them. I bought him 7 years ago. Don't like him anymore. No questions asked. I'll be like, all right, no problem.
It took 6 years, six and three quarter years to figure out.
I just, the heart wants what it wants. Ryan, last one. Speaking of the heart, this is near and dear and personal to me. Weddings in June.
They're in this world of ours with climate change. Yeah. In this climate, you either get a chance of rain or a chance of being caked in with forest fire smoke.
Yeah.
Or if you're in the North Shore, just on fire. So I'm going to sauce June weddings.
Are you excited for your June wedding? Yeah. I'm trying to give you an in to plug in some love.
Yeah, I'm really excited. It's becoming more and more real, and we're, you know, buying more booze and buying more stuff, and more people are getting excited, and I'm buying a plethora of gifts for everybody. As Geeta said, it's my wedding day, but she's the one getting showered in gifts.
Yeah.
And I think what I'm really excited about is just there's like a wave of people that I will be excited to see.
Mm-hmm.
And it won't be like, oh, there's eight people that are going to be there. Like, yeah. I think like, oh, I'm so excited to see the, you know, these old friends or this family or that. And then it's like, like, there's going to be like 50 people I'm excited to see there.
Yeah, I'm excited for you too. Everyone's excited. This is going to be the wedding. This is going to be the wedding to end all weddings.
Yeah, it's going to be the best wedding on June 22nd that we are attending.
It's crazy because I got to go to work next day.
Oh, no, you're not.
Yeah, I have to.
I'll talk to your parents.
No. Well, one of my parents is overseas.
I talked to her.
What'd she say?
She said, you're right.
You got to go to work?
No. Arash will not be working that day.
We'll see. we'll see, pal. I've done it before, but I'm going to be wrecked for that Monday show. Let me tell you, that Monday show, absolutely going to get... I'm done. Done. By the way, big news for the neighborhood.
There won't be a show that Monday.
There won't?
We're recording it on the Saturday.
Okay, I thought you said there was going to be two shows. Sorry, I'm just taking information I got from the source.
Yeah, there'll be one on the 16th and by the way, on the 22nd.
Well, I mentioned in the chat, Brekka, if you've never been in Vancouver, there's this amazing chain of bakeries in Vancouver called Brekka. They're open 24/7, make some of the greatest pastries known to man. One opened up just by our house.
That's true. I'll probably go there tonight.
It's game over. We're done. Any Patreon money you're going goes towards paying our dessert and pastry bills. It's game over. Ryan, it's game over. Ryan.
Speaking of game over, I think it's game over for the Panthers.
What are you talking about? 1-0.
Can't score a power play goal.
No one can score a power play goal on the Edmonton Oilers.
We did. Let's, here's a fun little quote from Paul Maurice about the Panthers. On taking over a good team in Florida, he goes, I showed up here and they were at 122 points. I managed to get them down to 92 in one year.
Jesus.
Brilliant.
let me tell you.
Arash.
Yes, Ryan. Yes, Ryan guy.
Salary cap.
Yeah, what about it?
Going up $4.5
million. Dang.
88 Schmill. It's the biggest jump in a decade.
Yeah.
Coming off the heels of the players finally paying off their portion of escrow debt incurred because of the revenue collapse in 2020. COVID. You might have heard about it. What does this mean for Vancouver?
What does this mean for the Vancouver Canucks? Well, they got more cap space to play with. They don't have to deal with the OEL thing, I believe, for one more year before it jumps up into the threes and fours for a couple years there. Basically, what this means for the Canucks is there's going to be a recalibration of player salaries. So this offseason, unfortunately for the Canucks in some way, you're going to see certain players go for higher than they'd normally go for. Just because agents are adjusting for the cap now. So there's going to be sticker shock. You know, for the Canucks offering a 7x7, let's say, to Elias Lindholm, in their minds, they're really that it's 7x6. If you, you know, you have to just prorate everything. Do I think they should give that to him? No.
No.
I feel like, you know, you can probably go, you know, if you have $3 or $4 million to spend on a 2-3 center, you know, there's space and things available there. And you can also, you know, put that money towards a winger for Elias Pettersson and figure it out from there. What it means for the Canucks in a positive way, this management group has shown, specifically if you look at even like the Pia Suter, Casey DeSmith, those kind of signings and everything, their wait-and-see approach on certain things. Opportunities arise for hockey teams outside of this free agency, the draft, trading, trades. Opportunities arise to acquire certain players. And this might be in a situation where, you know, we've seen it before where a team, you know, has to re-sign either an RFA or they want to sign a UFA that's an upgrade on someone they have, and then they got to ship someone out. And then those teams that have cap space can capitalize on acquiring said players. So, like, you know what's funny? Is Taylor Hall a UFA?
I don't know.
Can you chat for a minute?
What I'm thinking about all this is I kind of feel like this sizable increase of the salary cap is a bit of a worst case scenario for the Canucks UFAs that they really want to keep.
Dang.
Dakota Joshua, Philip Hronek, Elias Lindholm.
Yeah. So this is really interesting for me. So Taylor Hall is actually entering the last year of his contract, right? How old is he? 32. Yeah, he's 32. Entering the last year of his deal with the Chicago Blackhawks. He's making $6 million. He's in the last year. When you look at players like that, where it's I know Chicago has to meet the salary cap floor, but I'm also assuming Chicago wants to go and, you know, fill out some of this roster a bit and not just leave it, you know, for all of Connor Bedard's entry-level stuff to not be competitive for him to, you know, get to year 6 and 7. That's when the Vancouver Canucks check mark goes up where he's like, I want to go home. I did my time in Chicago. I want to go home. And then you do that. It's just about finding kind of those value players. When you have cap space, your acquisition cost is going to be lower. And then you can, you know, you fill out spaces like that. And I just think this Canucks team in front office, they've shown they can be creative. Mm-hmm. They've shown that they understand the kind of minutiae of how and where to acquire certain players in a creative way. You know, the Zadorov one we brought up where...
that's another guy that the cap going up this level.
Yeah, I mean, the cap going up this level, but at the same time, you know, I'm assuming they want to keep it below 5 on a, you know, a 6-year term. I'm fine with giving him a ton of term, but it's the AAV that needs to be kind of kept down and stuff as things kind of go up because, you know, $4 million or $4.5 million, you know, at a certain point for a third pairing defenseman, a quality third pairing defenseman with the cap going up as much as it is, that's not going to be something completely unheard of. You're not going to look at that when the cap's, you know, $95 million, $100 million or whatever and think, oh man, we got to work the budget. Our third pair, top pair, or our third pairing guy who's really good in that position is making too much money at $4 million, right? So it's the great recalibration for me.
Yeah.
In understanding people, like especially fans going into July 1, they're going to see some sticker shock on some players. You just have to understand that it's going to be prorated. Keeping in mind that the salary cap is going to kind of go up and up and up.
I'd like to see as little sticker shock as possible.
You're going to see a lot, pal.
With the Canucks.
Oh, with the Canucks? Oh, yeah.
But I think we're going to see that sticker shock with Elias Lindholm, Nikita Zadorov,
I think
Dakota Joshua.
I think Lindholm has Boston written all over him. All over him.
Why? Because he can't. He's
a perfect.
Because
fit.
He's structurally sound, but doesn't really score a lot of goals.
Because that's they. If you look at what the Bruins need,
Patrice Bergeron.
They need Kirkland Brand, Patrice Bergeron.
Yeah.
And in between Pasternak and Marchand, we'll see how many.
That'd
years
be an
Marchand
insane
has.
Line. Yeah.
But I mean, he's not this. He's this. He does the dirty work, and he's this off puck player. He's not a dominant puck possession guy.
Yeah.
Marchand is that. Pasternak to some point is that with kind of the volume shooting that he provides. But you need a guy that, you know, below the hash marks and everything does the work for you. He's a perfect fit on that line. And if Boston needs, offensive help in, you know, a 50, 60 point right-handed centerman who in the playoffs had, you know, he was great.
He was incredible.
It kind of just goes to show that that's kind of the niche fit for him. So we'll see what happens with the Canucks. But, you know, I'll say this. If it gets to a position in July 1 where, you know, the only players that they re-sign are like Myers and maybe they get Zadorov in, whatever, that's not necessarily a bad thing. This isn't a red wedding situation. Like, this is, you know, it's not necessarily a bad thing. Cap space is king. And when you have cap space, the league is open to you.
Yeah.
And that's how you have to kind of.
And if you get drunk on your cap space and you start buying and you realize,
don't do that. Don't. That's the biggest mistake that teams do is they hoard on July 1. They feel like it's a sale at, I don't know, the Bay, and they have to go and just get clothes and everything off the rack and not even look at sizes. They're like, we just need to consume.
We need to buy.
No, just, you know, stay back and just let the mongrels do what they need to do. And then in the secondary market, I mean, look at the value they got on the secondary market, right? The Teddy Bluger, Pia Suter later on in the year.
Exactly.
You know, trading for Casey DeSmith. You know, the Anthony Beauvillier trade, which, again, really goes to show that they know what the hell they're doing.
And luckily they'll have some draft picks after this one.
It's funny. I'm like, you know, they don't need to have a first or a second, but I wish, you know, they could somehow go and get a third and a fourth and just kind of give a little bit of chances for the scouting department to go and kind of mine some gold.
I just don't like what's in the hopper right now down on the farm.
Really?
There's not enough.
It's not enough. I like the Willander and Lakarimaki. I think they're going to be great.
They could be great. Nobody like.
They're
still what ifs.
I think they're going to be NHL players. I think at what level, Jonathan Lakarimaki, like depending on, you know, what kind of how much size and muscle he gets, how he adapts to a North American ice play. You know, and Tom Willander skates like the wind, has to figure out what his offensive ceiling is to some extent. And also with him, you know, his ceiling is high. No, sorry. His floor is really high. Like, he can be a top four guy.
Yeah.
It's just, is he going to be that Charlie McAvoy? You know, does he have enough offensive ceiling? Like, he's kind of perfect within a mindset of if he can understand how to work on his puck handling and everything to be Quinn Hughes's partner, you know, a little bit down the line. But then Hughes is going to be up for being a UFA, and we'll deal with that when we deal with it.
Yeah. Speaking of drafts, draft picks, speaking of prospects, this came out of the draft combine on the weekend in Buffalo. The Utah NHL team, which I think is going to be the Blizzard, the Yeti, the something else, or the something else, was asking draft prospects this week at the combine for their Uber passenger rating.
Oh, God. This is a little weird.
What would yours be?
Mine's 4.96.
Thank God I'm recording the podcast with my iPhone, so I can't look at it right now.
Yeah, it's 4.96. I just only assume. I want to know the dude who gave me a 4. I've been always so great.
You're probably, I don't know, you're probably rambling about Martin Natchez or something.
I don't know. Maybe you didn't tip. I got, no, I do tip. I 100% believe that probably I got Katie to, I grabbed one for Katie, and Katie has a mobility aid, and one of the dudes is like, I don't like people, almost scratch my car. Fuck you, dude. Fuck you, and you're thinking my girlfriend has disabilities.
I like...
Fuck yourself.
That's where your 4 out of 5 came from.
Probably. What else did I do? You know what would be a great draft question to ask? What's your favorite episode of The Office?
Yeah, that'd be a good...
Because then some people pick...
Kids are too young. They, like, The Office is like mashed to them.
No, they still watch The Office like crazy.
No,
yeah.
Not at all. Kids today?
What do they watch?
An 18-year-old? They don't watch TV.
What do they watch? You watch streaming services.
Yeah, they watch Mr. Beast. When's the last time you talked to...
They watch Pucks on Net.
Talk to an 18-year-old. They don't watch sitcoms.
You want me to go talk to an 18-year-old? Ryan, you want to...
I mean, you work
I need this for evidence for court that I was told to go talk to an 18-year-old.
If this was 10 years ago when it was...
Hey, you guys like Snickers bars?
I bet you. If you
come look in my... Go Volkswagen TDI. You guys want some...
Well, why are you offering these random mystery
children? You guys want
some
mango jewels?
Why are you offering them jewels and candy out of
your
car?
How else do I get kids into the car for a conversation?
You work in a restaurant.
I don't like to talk to customers I don't know. Well, I like to get them fed and then out.
So it's either that, you talk to customers, or you go to jail for luring people?
That's what you told me on the camera just now.
Listen.
Where's your head at?
You ask an 18-year-old what The Office is, they'll have no clue.
What's your favorite? Because my
dinner party.
Yeah, dinner party.
It's the best episode ever. In a subpar season, it's the best episode.
Hey, babe, can you not do that? You know I have soft teeth. How could you say that?
Oops. No, but I was going to say, what's a question you could ask an 18-year-old to kind of learn about their personality at the NHL Draft Combine?
Yeah.
What would be yours? What, anything come to mind?
Off the top of my head.
Yeah.
Well,
because we're old, so all the things...
A trap question would be like, you just had a night out. Where are you going for your last late night meal? And if anyone answers, I'm like, oh, so you... No, okay. And then everyone's like, actually, I don't. I'm at home and I have salad. And
you're like, good. We don't want to draft a nerd.
No, you got to know how to tie one on, pal.
Yeah, you're coming to Dallas.
Come on. You got to know what would be yours be.
That's like, I know they're really insane questions. Somebody asked...
What could you ask an 18-year-old Ryan Schaap?
Stein Solberg said he switched to defense when his 14... Stian Solberg said he switched to defense when he was 14 when a teammate peed in a shower and his coach told him he had to take his place at defense.
What an amazing way to just switch it up. Being like, yeah, I just don't like pee.
Oh, what would be a good question for kids today?
What would be like a... what would be a good...
You ever
thing?
Clear your browser history on your phone?
No.
So you have to ask the kids.
Oh, yeah.
And then when they say no, you bring in Mike Babcock.
Hey, kids.
Let's see it.
I'm your worst fucking nightmare.
Hand over the phone.
Give it to me.
I hear it's flush.
I don't care. Just give it to me. What's this?
Yeah, what are you asking an 18-year-old kid right now today to be
I
like
would do
that?
Browser history.
No,
Because that's how you parent kids nowadays.
I just feel like, hey, man, if a kid wants to go browse and stuff on the internet, that's their prerogative. If they're doing something illegal, then that's one thing. They're just, you know,
looking at hardcore pornography.
Whatever. I mean, listen, I'm just telling you, probably don't look at too much porn because it fucks with your head. I'm a
well, that's why you should
that.
Tell them not to delete their browser.
Well, I mean,
history.
It's their life. I mean, do whatever you want. I'm not going to kink shame any fucking newly adult kids.
These are children.
They're 18. They're adults. Fine. This is going off the rails. Why you brought this up?
Here's my question to those kids. What is the significance of Fleet Foxes?
What's the significance of Fleet Foxes? I would be like, this is a really good question. I'd love to know listeners' ideas of like what they would ask an 18-year-old kid in order to understand their thing.
I would love to,
one thing I would love to ask actually is, tell us what, like, how did the pandemic affect you? I would love to know what kids, because kids are going to be like, oh, I didn't see my friends.
Yeah, grade 9 or 10 for these
nine,
draft picks.
Well, you know, I just like you didn't see it. But I really want to know, like, what introspective answers, like, certain players would have in terms of being honest, of being like, yeah, it just made me look inward and I had to work on some stuff I felt like. And
or they're like, well, my parents didn't really care about the order, so we just played. It was a normal 2 years.
Well, my, I just, I think, well, you know, one kid comes out and says, well, I just, you know, it made me really want David Fauci to go to jail. I mean, it's, you know, it's insane.
I'd ask him.
Are you vaccinated?
No, here's not. Do you listen to Joe Rogan?
Oh, come on.
I think that'd be a good one.
Oh, podcasts. What podcasts do you listen to?
Oh, kids don't listen to podcasts.
What do kids do?
They don't listen
to podcasts. They don't watch The Office. What do they do?
Well, they're not 36.
What's your KDA on
what's porn? That?
KDA, kill death assist.
I don't get that.
It's in a first-person shooter. Your performance is defined by KDA.
Okay.
Yeah.
I don't know who you're asking me. Is that like a fuck, marry, kill thing?
No, it's kills means how many kills do you have. Mm. Deaths means how many times have you died. And assists means how many, how many of your like engagements with players have led to the opponents being killed. So you didn't get the kill, but your friend did because you also were shooting at the same guy. And that counts as an assist. So your KDA is, that's how you track it.
Mm. Interesting.
Yeah.
I don't know. I just think kids are so so different now. Like they don't watch sitcoms. They text with Snapchat with blurry selfies to send it across, and they just don't give a shit about old people stuff like The Office.
Yes.
And it sucks because we had our heyday where, you know, 2015. If anybody watched anything on streaming, it was The Office, and now we don't even have anything.
No.
We're rudderless.
What do we do? There's nothing, Ryan.
There's
no news. I thought Martin Aitches would be traded by now.
It's the...
What are we doing?
I don't know.
Let's talk about our feelings. How you
well,
doing?
As we're wrapping up the podcast now.
Oh, nice, pal.
You can talk about your feelings on 5 minutes or paying. Available at patreon.com/pucksonnet. $5 donation will get you...
It is almost 27 degrees. The hoodie, let me tell you.
Why are you... Yeah, we'll talk about that.
I love this hoodie. I bought it for $30 at the team store.
That's right.
It's so comfy.
We'll talk about what we bought at the Canucks...
at the Canucks team store sale and the end of the year sale.
Yeah, we'll do that on Patreon. If you want to support the show, go to youtube.com/pucksonnet if you're not watching us there, and hit subscribe. Give us some money, buy a shirt, and tell a friend. And we're going to go to Patreon now, and we'll talk to you later.
Bye. Hello, this is Roger R. Smith calling from TinnenMed. I have two quick questions. How about that Sergei Bobrovsky? And question to you, have the Oilers met their match? I kind of think we have.